The amount of space a sliding gate needs to open is normally the gate opening plus 400 millimeters or so. The gate opening being the distance between the fence posts either side of the driveway. If the space to open is limited, then a sliding gate may have two panels that stack one in front of the other. These are commonly known as telescopic or stacker gates and need only half the gate opening plus 300 millimeters or so to open. If there isn't even enough space for a two-panel telescopic gate, three panels can be used, as these require only one-third of the gate opening plus 300 millimeters or so to open. Four panels are also possible. How it works is a normal sliding gate motor operates the back panel, as it normally would, and a wire rope wrapped around a wheel on the back gate pulls the front gate along at twice the speed. A second wire rope pulls the front gate in the opposite direction when the back panel is closing. The wire ropes both connect to a bracket on the front panel at one end and a bracket on the ground at the other end. The wheels for the wire rope are cut into the bottom rail to make the most of what space there is. This way, the overlap between the panels is as small as 80 millimeters. A three-panel telescopic gate has a middle panel that works the same as the front panel of a two-panel telescopic gate, traveling at twice the speed. The front panel is now driven by a second set of wire ropes and wheels fitted to the middle panel, with a bracket on the front panel at one end and another bracket on the back panel at the other end. The middle panel now pushes the front panel at four times the speed. The middle and back panels end up beyond the post because the brackets can't go past the wheels. The wheels for the middle panel are also cut into the bottom rail, but are set higher than those on the back panel so they don't clash. The guide system uses standard block, channel and rails, with one fitted between a guide post and the back panel and the others fitted between the panels. The guide block and its channel are 80 millimeters wide, so fit nicely into the overlap between the panels. If a 32 millimeter wide guide rail is used, and the guide channel is fitted to the front of the back panel, there will be a gap of 81 millimeters between the panels, which is handy if you want to fit timber to the front of the gate, up to 34 millimeters thick. Although the front panel needs to be set back far enough behind the fence to allow for the thickness of timber plus 15 millimeters clearance. If you don't want to fit anything to the front of the gate and would rather have a smaller gap between the panels, a 25 millimeter wide guide rail can be used and the guide channel cut into the frame by up to 20 millimeters, bringing the total gap between the panels down to 55 millimeters. Although this is a bit of fiddling about when making the gate. If you want to use timber wider than 34 millimeters, then the guide channel needs to be packed out by the extra amount needed. The motor normally needs to be packed up by 25 to 38 millimeters so the rack clears the wire rope. If there's battens or something similar fitted to the front of the gate, this must stop short from the bottom, so it clears the wire rope and its hardware. The front gate should be made to match, Even though the battens don't need to clear a wire road, it makes it less obvious and more consistent from a visual point of view. If you're really close to having enough space for a two-panel telescopic gate to open, but not quite enough, there's a couple of tricks that can be done to make one fit without having to go to three panels. Firstly, if you use an overhead guide bracket instead of a guide post, the motor can be hard up against the driveway, so a shorter extension to the bottom rail can be used and the gate requires less room to open. Although this does require the gate being lower than the fence, so the overhead bracket isn't seen from the road. If you'd like to have the gate at the same height as the fence, a guide post can be fitted on the other side of the motor with a bracket reaching over to the gate where the guide block needs to be. The second trick is to use a narrow motor that has a built-in limit system that allows the end of the rack to come close to the output gear of the motor when the gate is closed, and doesn't need much, if any, extension to the bottom rail of the gate, so uses even less space to open. With telescopic gates, the back panel is further back from the fence than the front panel, which leaves a large gap, which is easily fixed by adding a return, which is a small infill panel added to the back gate panel. It's added to the back gate panel rather than the fence, so it moves out of the way of the front panel as the gate opens. Telescopic gates may go on driveways that slope across, even if it's quite steep. This is done by raking the gate, which means making the gate out of square so it fits the slope of the driveway. Ideally, the track the gate rolls on is straight and on the same slope as the driveway. Although the driveway doesn't need to be dead straight, as each panel can have a different rake so it fits an uneven driveway. And when the gate opens, two panels can ride over an uneven track much better than a single panel sliding gate, a bit like the carriages of a train. If the ground slopes steeply up from the edge of the driveway, a telescopic gate needs much less excavation and retaining than a single panel sliding gate, saving money and causing much less disruption to the property. The motor for a telescopic gate needs to be more powerful than that for a single panel sliding gate, and if it's on a slope, it needs to be even more powerful again. Telescopic gates on a slope still use a block and rail guide system. Although the guide blocks and channels need to be at right angles with the guide rail, and end up being at an odd angle to the vertical members of the gate and the guide post. If the tops of each panel were level, this may be a better option because it keeps the nylon blocks and channels nice and square. And if the gate is opening downhill, the guide blocks move down in their channels as the gate opens, so the guide rails can be at the very top of the gate. Although if opening uphill, the guide rails need to be set lower down on the gate, because the guide blocks now move up as the gate opens, and we don't want them popping out the top. To keep the size of each panel more consistent, the level tops can be stepped, although the guide rails for these need to be lower down by at least the amount of the step, even if the gate is opening downhill. Otherwise, the guide blocks and channels will need to be higher than the fence and gate. If opening uphill, the guide rails could be at the top, but the guide block and its channel in the middle of the gate would be visible from the road, so it looks nicer if the guide rails are lower down on both panels. Slope from the direction of the road has little effect, so long as the footing has the same slope as the driveway in both directions.